Representatives of the Templin Institute recently had the honor of being welcomed aboard the Kar-Kashan, flagship of the Hagaran Navy, and my thanks to all the folks in the 15th Squadron for receiving us and being such excellent hosts. It was an exciting opportunity to see how far the Hagarans have come from their exile on Karak, through their journeys across the galaxy, to their current role as a major power on the galactic stage. And while we'll have plenty more to say in the near future about what is personally one of my favorite alternate worlds, I'd instead today like to take part in a bit of ship spotting. We had the opportunity to witness vessels representing roughly half of the Hagaran roster in action, so I'll be going through each one and giving you my brief thoughts and observations. And let's get this right out of the way. If you're a fan of dollar-intensive interstellar ordnance delivery vectors, or spaceships, the layman, you'll have a lot to look at in this universe. The designs of the Hagaran, Tidan, and Vegar fleets are some of the most iconic ever put into service, and I'm happy to report that the tradition continues. You may have seen these ships from a distance, but they look just as phenomenal in action. So what better place to start than with the Kar-Kashan itself? To say this vessel has some big shoes to fill doesn't quite cover it, but I think this latest iteration of the Hagaran flagship is truly exceptional, and like those that came before it, its design can tell us a few things. The very first mothership was intended to establish interstellar colonies, while the Pride of Hagara that followed was principally a warship, and you can see their intended role reflected in each design. The Kar-Kashan, to my eye, seems to be doubling down on the warship concept. The coverage of its armor plating is more widespread, its subsystems are further assessed into the main structure, while its more angular and lower profile just reinforces the idea that this was designed for combat first and foremost, not necessarily leading the main battle line, but as a support ship expected to take some fire from time to time. I love this design. It's sleek, graceful, and elegant, but it also looks like it has some teeth to it. As a long-standing advocate for more flying wing designs across alternate worlds, I love the look of the Kar-Kashan and its horizontal orientation. The Arsenal Bird of the Ocean Federation finally has some competition. But as someone whose heart belongs to the classics, I appreciate the ability to engage in typical banana mode. The various liveries used by the different kiths, fleets, and squadrons are also just beautiful. Bold paint schemes like this add so much personality to a design. And I think the warships of other interstellar navies, from Star Destroyers to the USS Enterprise, could really learn a lesson here. And while I could say that about any of the ships in this quick showcase, I think you'll agree the new mothership makes the best canvas to show off what I mean. Moving on to Hagaran aerospace fighters, we have two distinct models optimized towards a reconnaissance and interceptor role, respectively. Interestingly, you can see some elements from both the scout and interceptor fighters of the Vegar era in each of these new designs, almost like the development of fighter and recon craft briefly merged together before getting split again into two separate, though similar, designs. And I really like these next-generation Hagaran fighters. In the past, we've seen the Hagaran Navy evolve from a loose collection of distinct starships, some of which might have been stolen from the Tidan, to far more uniform, utilitarian designs that look like they've been purpose-built by a dedicated navy. Now what I think we're seeing is those more utilitarian designs evolving again into something that retains their lethality, but is starting to get just a bit more graceful and elegant in its aesthetics. Maybe the result of a more relaxed, peacetime design environment. Moving quickly onto the bomber, what stands out here is the blended wing body that you see often in Hagaran designs, dating all the way back to the comparatively primitive gunships used by the Northern Coalition on Karak. Another interesting detail is what appears to be a more armored cockpit, probably a good idea for a slower strike craft diving headfirst into flak fire. This is another update I'm very happy with. Next up, we have the Hagaran frigates dedicated towards anti-starship warfare. That's the torpedo frigate, assault frigate, ion frigate, and the suppression frigate. Those first three are the foundational building blocks of the Hagaran Navy, and probably familiar to you, while the Suppression Frigate is the latest iteration of the Flak Frigate. Notably, it replaces multiple point defense turrets with a single forward-mounted autocannon array. It seems less able to defend itself or ships it's escorting against strike craft, all maneuvering independently of one another at close range, but very effective against squadrons moving in formation at long range. In terms of design, I initially assumed that these all shared a similar hull template with just some modular equipment swapped around. So I was pleased to see they're all similar, but ultimately unique designs with distinct hull shapes and loadouts. Having a diverse looking fleet might not make it perform better in combat, but it does make it more appealing to look at. If I had one complaint though, it's that each warship is very specialized in the types of weapons they carry. The torpedo frigate, for example, has no secondary armament and is almost useless against enemy strike craft. Other ships aren't quite that focused, and most do include point defenses, but a greater variety of weaponry across frigates would have been cool. In terms of starship design philosophy, I'm more of a fan of those that follow the standards of our modern world, in which even specialized classes of warships might still carry a multitude of weapons not directly related to their primary role. You know, just in case. Of course, when you can manufacture starships on the fly, and they'll almost always be operating in groups, the necessity for a multi-role design might not be as urgent. Hagarin doctrine seems to favor collective capability over individual versatility, in a similar way to how certain modern armored fighting vehicles are designed in our own world. And hey, at least the larger Hagarin cruisers are all armed to the teeth. But let's move on to the resource controller. Because as rad as it is to imagine oneself as a fighter ace weaving through weapons fire in the middle of a fleet action, I'd probably be a lot more comfortable hanging out in one of these things, watching my drones do their thing, eating a donut, hanging out on the bridge, just living it up. And I suspect the Hagarin Navy might have brought in some consultants from the Lynx Corporation because their auxiliary craft have never looked better. I'm a sucker for the big, bright, yellow industrial starship aesthetic, and this is a great example of it working extremely well. The big searchlights on the bow conjures up images of fleets of these things, working their way through dust clouds and asteroid fields, rugged space truckers just doing the dirty work that keeps interstellar civilization moving. I love it. And for now, at least, we'll end this fleet review here, but there's plenty of starships left to talk about. In the near future, we'll be returning to investigate further the Hagarin Navy and the forces arrayed against them. But having been such a fan of the aesthetics of these starships, I hope my fellow ship spotters have enjoyed this early look as much as I have. So until next time, this has been a Templin Dispatch.